Hi, I'm Tony Oliver, and you're watching a Toonami Faithful podcast exclusive. Keep watching.
Okay. Hello, my name is Jim from the Toonami Faithful podcast. This is my assistant, CJ Mafris. Assistant.
Hi, guys.
assistant, co-producer, whatever you want to put it as. So, as is well known now, you worked on Power Rangers,
yes.
Mighty Morphin, and... I forget if there was anything later after that, but so in the second season, the White Ranger and the Thunderzords, the footage for those came from Gosei Sentai Die Ranger. However, the production team opted to get all new Sentai footage instead of just changing the uniforms to what they might have been, to what they would have been in Die Ranger. So was it do you know if it was a marketing decision to change the not change the costumes for Mighty Morphin, as opposed to just using changing them and using Die Ranger footage?
Well, at the time we were still looking at how things were going, and the idea of changing every year like the Japanese do was kind of far away from our vision, because that's not the way we, in the past, things were done here. You got a cast, you stuck with them. I don't remember why we decided to do it the way we did it, but the fact was is that we had intended Tommy to be a temporary character like he was in the Zhu Ranger. But he was so well received by the public and the fan mail and all that stuff that we had to figure out a way to keep him in the show. And one way was to mix and match generations of Sentai footage in order to kind of take a story until we could get to the next full set of Sentai that allowed us to bring him in. And I think that's when he became a Red Ranger at that point.
Yes.
Because Tommy's been like every color. Yeah. So... So most of that had to do with we wanted to maintain the continuity of something that didn't exist in the Japanese, and yet we had to do it because we basically painted ourselves into a very nice corner. That's a good problem to have, by the way. Mm-hmm. When people are going, no, we want more of that. That's the best thing you ever want to hear when you're doing a show. But when you're out of footage, you got to figure out what else to do.
Right.
So most of those decisions were made along those lines.
Yeah. Okay. So unbeknownst to me,
well, you're pulling up the real obscure stuff.
Yes, but played a really good role in my childhood. So, when it came to adapting the original Fushigi no Kawanoblanki for an American audience, were there some things in the original that you had to change due to cultural differences between Japan and America?
There always are, even today. I mean, there are things that you either have to soften or explain, or in terms of comedy, simply ignore and do something that's more culturally funny. I'll tell you, Newsles was was early in my career when I first was starting to adapt ADR and things like that. And at the time, the standard was not to match the Japanese. The standard was to do a show that American audiences would like. So I never saw a translation on the show. I had no idea what was actually happening in the Japanese dialogue. We just made the dialogue up and followed the story that we saw on the picture. That said, yeah, I'm sure there were a lot of things changed, but we had no idea we were changing them because we were changing everything. So that the standard changed somewhere in the mid-90s. The only people that still do that is the Four Kids guys and stuff, but everybody else is pretty much all about purity these days. Well, purity in that it still has to be relatable and understandable to and accessible to English-speaking audiences. So we do make cultural changes all the time, but as little as we can possibly get away with. But on Newsles, we did everything.
So with the recent changes in Toonami, where they added an older show, Samurai Champloo, which is a very big favorite with a lot of fans, it made me start to question, well, if they're going to bring an old series like that, why can't they bring other old series that has a pretty decent following, or at least a fan favorite among some people? And I was wondering, how would you feel if Gadgard, that you starred in, would also make it on the block? Because I think it's a series that's underrated, that isn't appreciated enough, because it was really fun watching.
Thanks. I think it is a cute little show that nobody saw. I think they will. I think what you're seeing now is, as anime is starting to mainstream even more and more and more, with Netflix making a commitment to it, with Hulu making a commitment to anime, they're going to run out of product quickly, and what they're doing to go there, it's much less expensive for the networks to go back in time and pull stuff up from the back. Samurai Champloo was very popular at the time that it was on, and so you might see a show like Gadgard. But the best way to do that is to get a letter writing campaign, frankly, and have people do that. But I think you're going to be seeing more and more old school stuff coming back, that's never aired before, because that gives them some exclusivity. But we'll see, because there's a new deal that's going on with film Funimation Production IG and Netflix to do original pieces. And if that continues, if that's successful and continues to build up thing, I think you're going to see a lot of these networks going back and grabbing old stuff, especially if there's fans that are requesting it. So.
Loop on the Third has always been my favorite performance of yours.
Well, thank you very much.
Because not only did you get his mentality down right, but you were able to capture that same energy and that amazing performance that you heard in the original Japanese, whether it was Yasuo Yamada or Kenichi Kureda. But I overheard a rumor that you initially weren't supposed to play Lupin. You filled in like last minute or something.
No, I think that's been kind of distorted a little bit. The fact is, I was not called in to audition for Lupin. I was called in to audition, I think it was for Goemon. But while I was there, I also read for Jigen, and I read for all of them, including Zenigata, and was surprised to get called back for all three of the baddies, and was even more surprised when I was cast. What did happen, though, is the voice that I was using when they cast me, and when we put it on the show, and the way they were conceptualizing pulling up the comedy a little bit more, because it was a Cold War comedy, so they had to fix things and bring it up to date. They didn't fit, so they asked me to do it a different way. So after I finished doing the first episode, we came back and we redid it again. This time with me doing more of a Robin Williams kind of voice, and they didn't like that either. About halfway through that, they had me change to more of a Jim Carrey kind of thing. They didn't like that either. And so by the time we got done, we had ended up with a voice. The third time I did the first episode, because I recorded it three times. The third time I recorded it, we did with the voice that we ended up with, which actually wasn't quite the voice it is now. It kind of evolved into, because it was a little lower pitch at the time. And everybody felt that fit with the rest of the characters. So it wasn't that I filled in at the last minute. It was that we just weren't quite settled on what she should sound like until we did the first episode three times. Well, I did. Not everybody else. It was just me that had to do it. So
you have been in the dubbing ADR industry for a, quite frankly, a ridiculously long period of time. My first exposure to you was Robotech in the mid-80s.
Yeah.
So what would you say has been the most seismic change in dubbing, whether how it's done or anything else regarding the process since the 80s?
Good question. Well, there's two sides to that answer. One of the things that's changed dramatically was the technology. So when we first started, when I did Robotech, we were working on 3/4-inch videotape cassettes, which are these huge, they look like Betamaxes on steroids, and on reel-to-reel audio tape that we would sync up. And so it was a very laborious and slow process. We'd record it and have to rewind everything and wait for the rewind and wait for all the machines to lock up, and then we'd have to roll until they all locked up into sync, and then, you know, we're using old space-age technology to sync everything up. And so it took a while. So maybe we could get 10 to 15 lines an hour done. I was pretty fast. You used to get like 18, so they thought it was pretty cool. But that's one of the reasons I stayed employed, I think. And the studio costs are fixed. It's hourly, you know, and they have to pay the engineer and all that stuff. Well, when digital showed up, suddenly you weren't rewinding quite so much. You didn't have to edit quite so much because it was a cleaner track. You could actually use software to clean up tracks. When picture went digital, that changed everything. So now these days, if I have a good actor with a good script, because I direct a lot, when a good actor with good script, we can do 40, 50, 60 lines an hour. And there's new technology coming up that allow you to even go faster than that. And what that does for you is it drops the production costs way down because you're using a lot less studio time, which is what fueled the anime revolution in the 90s. That's why it surged, because suddenly it was inexpensive enough to be able to make a profit doing these at such the low cost that you have to charge for them. So that was the game changer there. The game changer on the creative side was basically movies like The Matrix coming up, where Japanese culture was becoming infused in our mainstream entertainment, and it became more accessible and more understandable to the audience. This anime stuff, now it looks more familiar, it's not quite so foreign, and it started to mainstream. And so once it started to mainstream, it's kind of grown up now and it's become what it is. I mean, this is an amazing weekend here with so many people, you know, coming to see this. And that wasn't really possible until those two changes happened.
Mm-hmm. So going back to Loop on the Third, your buddy Richard Epcar revealed that you were all reuniting to dub the fourth season. So
yes. We're done. We did it. Yeah.
So were you excited to be putting on the blue jacket again? Or rather, for the first
time? Yeah. It was lovely to... I'm not even sure we're supposed to talk about this, but it was lovely to be asked and to be recognized and to have that recognized as something that people wanted to do. And it was fantastic to be reunited with all... it's all the original cast from the Red Jacket series, with the exception of Dan Lorget, who left acting for teaching, so we had somebody else's playing Zenigata. But even the person who's playing Zenigata really brought the essence of the original. It's just a slightly different voice, but brought his essence is still there. The funny part of Zenigata is still there. And it was great. It was an interesting story arc. It was a little different, a little more serious, a little more sexy than before. So I'm thrilled. I can't wait for it to come out.
Do we have a date yet?
I wish I did. I don't. We're the last people to be told any of that stuff.
A staple for not only Toonami but for Adult Swim action was Bleach. It's a show that I remember fondly. It was one of their longest running shows on Adult Swim. Mm-hmm. And of course, your villain, maybe not as polarizing as Aizen, as some people would say, but you really did a good job with Ukiora and like making people want to hate him when he was with Orihime doing all that stuff. So I'm kind of wondering how you went into the process of voicing him, because like he just seems so like depressed all the time, so it must have been a little difficult just like to hold back the energy when you're acting and doing that stuff.
It is, and I'm going to give a lot of credit to Wendy Lee. Wendy Lee was directing the show at the time, and really made me focus on what was important and yank back the acting. You know, our tendency is to overact, and just less acting, and really push all of the internal feelings. And it's really one of the hardest parts I've ever played. Easy vocally, but really difficult acting wise, because he has no heart. He literally has a hole. Yet he has emotion that's buried. So I had to play it more like emotion that I can't feel, that it's there, but I can't really feel it. And spent an awful lot of time in the first few episodes, especially coming up with a way in which to be creepy and dark and emotional and yet completely flat and monotone because that's where the creepiness comes from. So it was really hard. But Wendy is a terrific director, and she led me there. Every week I'd go in and go, stop acting, less acting. And because it's such a complex story, I'll tell you a funny story. The very first day I was starting, I walked in, because I've started like episode 150 or something like that. And I walked in and I said, okay, well, this is Bleach. I've heard of it. You want to give me a quick rundown of what this story's about? You know, and 15 minutes later, I went, stop. let's just record. Just tell me how to read the line. but at the end, you know, when he leaves and he finally finds love, I mean, that actually makes... I'm glad that she made me do that, because it made the ending much more poignant as it comes back around when he dies. It was a hard one to do, but it was fun and very satisfying as a result.
So. Do you miss the fact that the show's ended as well, that it's like over for right now?
Well, yeah, I always miss my characters. I do. I'm surprised it lasted so long. I can't believe I'm still doing Naruto. It's like, I was dead before the show started, but wow, this keeps going.
So out of all the characters that you've portrayed, who do you relate to the most?
Good question. There's a piece of me in every character. All right. I think the only way that you can act a character effectively is if you're reaching into yourself and yanking out of your own personality that particular aspect and focusing on it. So I don't know if I can answer that question honestly, you know, accurately, in that there's a little piece of me in everybody. I think probably the character closest to me personality-wise at the time I did it was Rick Hunter, because I really was a brand new. I was just playing me in that situation because I didn't know how to do it any other way. That was my very first series. I was terrified. I was going to get fired. I had no idea. You know, what is this? I mean, you know, anime wasn't big here. I had seen anime before, but didn't know it. You know, I was a kid. I watched Speed Racer and Gigantor. I had no idea they were Japanese. So, So that was so I think Rick is probably the closest to my personality at the time that I did it. I'm more of a character actor now, so I play a lot of things that are far away from me, and I actually find that more fun.
I guess that ties into this question. If it wasn't Rick Hunter, then which role was it that made you think, yeah, this is here to stay? This, you know, my ability to be a voice actor, whether it's anime or something else, is, you know, going to work.
I'll let you know. actors are notoriously insecure people. And so there's never, I tell my students this because I teach a lot of workshops, and I'd love you guys to let me promote that. I would really appreciate it. I teach my students that there's no one character, no one part or audition that makes or breaks a career. It's really a conglomeration of things. And I got to say, I think it wasn't until after I left Saban and went back into voice, because I left voice acting for about 10 years, went back into voice acting that I felt confident that I could always be employed. And so far, so good. But this, even then, during the recession, it was horrible. It was 2 years I didn't direct an anime, didn't touch an anime, did a bunch of video games, but that was about it. And so, you know, it's still up and down, but it was way into career before I felt comfortable with that I could make a living just as a voice actor. That said, I make my primary living as a director, so...
Mm-hmm. And I'm curious to know what sort of things you taught him when it came to bringing like the right amount of evil to the recording.
I wish I could take credit for that, but I had left the show by the time he got there.
Oh, really?
So yeah, he was directed by a guy named Scott Page Pagter, who now directs Barbie stuff at Mattel, but he works with Eric Lembeck. It's interesting who's here. I never met Brian, and I wish I had. It would have been kind of fun, but I was not the guy that taught him anything.
Oh, okay.
Brian could teach me quite a few things, let me tell you. I'd love to meet the man.
One thing that I found interesting in a series that was really, I guess you could say like a little favorite of mine is the Fate Stay Night series where you work as Lancer. Not only were you in the 2006, but you also were able to reprise that role where that wasn't usually the case with a lot of other characters. So how did exactly that work out where they were able, where you were able to reprise that role?
Well, it has to do with the history of it. I mean, it was Fate Stay Night, which is based on a game, and the game had several paths. It was a visual novel. And so the original Fate Stay Night was one path of that. Then Aniplex brought us Fate Zero, which I directed. And it was the same universe, but a completely different style, much darker, much more cinematic. And they liked the way I directed it, and I love it's my favorite thing I've ever worked on ever. I think it's the best show quality wise that I've ever had the privilege to have a chance to be a part of, and they did a great job with it. And and when they brought back Unlimited Blade Works, they did look at the Unlimited Blade Works is Fate Stay Night in the Fate Zero style, and it is a slightly different story path. So the idea was to bring back to kind of combine the casts. So since I played him here, I'm going to play him here. I also played him in the movie. Most of the cast came across from Fate Zero, but some were brought in from the original thing. And it was basically to blend it, to make the transition a little easier and a little cleaner, and to keep us on the same path. Because I believe, I don't know this for sure, but I believe there's more coming. So, I don't know if we're going to get it or if it's going to come to the States and we're going to dub it, but there's more coming. And so I think they wanted to set a consistent tone between those two shows in order to go forward. And that's why they did that. But thank you. No, sometimes I don't get to reprise roles that I've done before.
It was just weird that, like, out of all of them, I noticed, oh, wait, this one stayed the same.
I got to tell you, Aniplex is very good about that. They very much care about continuity, and because they feel their business model is to create collectibles and to create stuff that's got a little bit of... some legs that's going to last a while. And so they're very careful about how they cast and stuff like that. And so that's why they did it. They're a great company to work with.
Later.